I'm Chahir Zaki. I'm Associate Professor of Economics at Cairo University and working as Lead Economist at the Economic Research Forum. We'll be happy to do the training workshop over the next 4 days, so 2 days this week and 2 days next week. So I suggest before we start the workshop, we have a tour de table where each one you will present yourself. So your name, your institution, your affiliation, I mean, and what is your field of expertise or your research interests, okay? So I will go with the order that we have in the list of participants. So the first one, and please turn on your camera just for the introduction at least. Abdullah Darandari, would you please introduce yourself?
Hello.
Hello.
Sorry for that. My name is Abdullah Darandari. I am from CAPSARC. I'm an economist here in the energy and macroeconomics department. I most likely work with the econometric type modeling, and I wanted to utilize my skills further by looking into other type of modeling techniques such as CGE. I work a lot with input-output tables, so I have some background on how CGE is kind of an extension of it with SAM, the SAM social accounting matrix. So I'm looking forward to this. I work a lot with the energy and macro intersection, looking at how Saudi Arabia is transitioning from a planned market economy to a market-fledged economy. So it's a very interesting technique for me to learn from. So I'm excited to be here. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Just a second. Abd Karim Al Qadri.
Yeah, hey, my name is Abdul Karim Al Qadri. I'm from George Washington University. Most of my research interest is international economics, international finance. Hopefully, I'm looking forward to learn a lot from your expertise, and it's gonna be like a great tool to be added to my econometrics tool. Hopefully, we're gonna benefit from your experience in the next 4 days. Thank you so much.
Alaeddin Al Tarawni.
Assalamu alaikum. Good evening, everyone. I'm Alaeddin Al-Tarawna, Business Economics Department at the University of Jordan. I'm Associate Professor. My research interest field is financial economics. I'm sometime dealing with data with general equilibrium. I'm doing some research about the fiscal policy and this stuff. I'm looking forward to benefit from this powerful expert. Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you. Ayam Etwali.
Hello everyone. مش عارفة أنا إيه طلعت معكم في الـ ERF statistical research يعني.
Yes please, okay. I mean introduce yourself, no worries, even if you're at the ERF.
I'm graduate from Faculty of Economic and Political Science Cairo University. بس هو بعمل أولادي statistical research.
Okay, thank you. شرف الدين مصير.
Yes, I'm here. My name is Sharaf Dimoussir. I'm 28 years old, and I'm a PhD researcher at University Ibn Tufayl, Kenitra, Morocco. This online training will be an opportunity for me to develop my knowledge on tools for evaluating economic development issues with the general equilibrium models.
Thank you, Sharaf al-Din. Hassan Chokic Kibir. Hassan? Okay, Hadir Ahmed. Hadir Ahmed, would you please present yourself? Okay. Now, yes.
I am Hadir Ahmed. I am a teaching assistant at the Egyptian University, Egyptian Russian University. I have a pre-master in economics, and I feel this courses will help me to know more about the economics. Thank you.
Thank you. Hossam al-Din Ibrahim. Hossam al-Din Ibrahim. Okay, so Hossam has some network and microphone problems. Ibrahim and Nafra.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Ibrahim and Nafra. I am a lecturer at Damascus University. My research expertise is innovation systems, and I would like to acquire a new skills to help me to measure the impact of external and internal shocks on the innovation activities using this SDG models. Thank you.
Thank you, Ibrahim. Lina Al-Badri.
Hello, everyone. Sorry, I can't open my camera right now. I'm Lina Al-Badri. I'm working as an economist at the US Embassy at Cairo. My main portfolio is macroeconomic, finance, banking, and entrepreneurship. So this course is really useful to me because it will help me during my analysis and evaluating the economy. Thank you.
Thank you, Lina. Mohammadu Nasruddin.
Hello, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, so my name is Nasruddin Mohammadu. I am from Mauritania. I have a PhD in international public policy and economics from Osaka University in Japan. And I just recently joined the United Nations Development Program as a project manager. And I still do research as an economist, independent economist. And my main research topics are labor economic, international trade, development economic, and so on. So thank you for having me in this training.
Thank you. Nadine Ale Dsoui. Nadine Ale. Perhaps she's not here. Nesma Amir.
Hello, everyone. My name is Nesma Amir. I'm a PhD student in statistics, and I am a senior statistician now at ERF. My academic background is mathematical statistics and computer science. And I am a specialist now in mathematical statistics as my PhD is as my research in PhD. But it's a great challenge for me to match the applied and the the mathematical or the theoretical statistics. So I attended this course or this workshop for that. Thank you.
Thank you. Oznur Oztamar.
Hello, everybody. You hear me, I think. I'm Oznur from Turkey. I'm working as an associate professor in the İzmir Bakırçay University and in the Department of Economics. I'm teaching mostly microeconomics courses, and my research also based on microeconomics, more specifically health economics, on evaluation of social policies and public policies. I use mostly econometric models in my research, but I'm quite new in CG. Actually, it will be my first experience here. So Zahir, thank you very much for these 2 weeks. I hope I will get a lot from you. Thanks.
Thank you. Rafi Abu Ali.
Hello, everyone. Good evening. My name is Rafi Abu Ali. I am from Palestine. I work as a statistician in Palestinian Bureau of Statistics, mainly in national accounts. My experience 3 years in supply and use table, and my I am so interested to know more about general equilibrium models. And I have a master's degree in development economics from Doha Institute. Also, I have BA in economics. Thank you.
Thank you, Rafa. Rami Al-Azhari.
Hello, everyone. Could you hear me?
Yes.
Hello, good evening, everyone. I'm Romi Husni Lazhari, lecturer of economics at Zagzag University. My interest is related to financial markets and financial economics. And I have a slight interest in regional economics. I think I can get benefits of this workshop as I will develop my skills regarding the CG models. That's all. Great to hear from you all.
Thank you, Rami. Rania Hashem.
Good evening, everyone. I hope you're doing well. Hello, my name is Rania Hashem from Morocco. I already have some knowledge on the main theme of training, as I'm a PhD student in economic analysis and modeling, University Mohammed V Rabat, Morocco, where I had a course and experience in methods of evaluation of public policies. Thank you.
Thank you, Rania. Salahuddin Suman.
Hi, everyone. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, we do.
Yes, I'm Salahuddin. I'm a research associate at CAPSARC with Abdelila. It's been 2 years that I joined CAPSARC, coming from France, where I used to apply some CGE techniques on the region of the GCC. So I have a previous experience, and I'm looking forward to extend my knowledge, especially in the GAMS language. Back to you, Chai.
Thank you. Shebnem Arik.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Shebnem Arik, and I'm from Turkey. I completed my PhD in economics at Athens University in Turkey, and I'm working as an independent researcher now. My research centers on international trade and specifically competitiveness and industrial policy. I'm very excited about the opportunity of joining this workshop and with this training, being able to use CG models in my study will allow me to investigate the impact of industrial and trade policies. Thank you.
Thank you, Chebnem. So I think now we're fine. Yes. Okay, so thank you all for the introduction. The group is quite diverse, the geographical, the specialization, and the fields of interest levels. So what we'll be doing, so the objective of today's session, I will first present what we'll be doing during the 4 days of the training workshop. Then I will start with a general introduction to CGE modeling and to what extent CGE modeling is different from econometric modeling. And then we go into more details of the CGE models of GAMS code and how we can build our own model, okay? So the objective of this workshop is to provide you with an introduction to CGE modeling. If you haven't ever worked with the GAMS language, then you can use, you'll be able to learn how to write a code in GAMS. So that's why we're going to divide this workshop into five main, I would say, parts. The first part will be more theoretical, where we're going to see the theoretical underpinnings of CGE modeling at both the micro and the macro level. And that's why we will need to have some refreshments of the basic microeconomic and macroeconomic tools that we need and that we have to have in mind when we build a CGE model. The third point will be seeing the model, some basic or simple models of CGE, and fourth, how to write these models in GAMS with all the types of errors that we can get in GAMS. And finally, what kind of data do we need? Macro data especially. And I have seen that some of you have already worked with input-output tables or supply-use tables. So all these kind of data sets are very relevant for our work, because the social accounting matrix is the main source of data that we need, and it's based on input-output tables and supply-use tables. So by the end of the 4 days, you'll be able to master the GAMS code. That's one. Two, build simple models. And three, as I always say in any kind of empirical work, whether it's econometrics or CGE modeling or any kind of modeling in general, it's learning by doing process. So during those 4 days, we really have the basics of modeling. But at the end of the day, if you don't work on GAMS, try to get different codes and try to replicate these codes using GAMS and using your own data, you'll not really be able to master CGE modeling. So that's in general what we'll be doing during the 4 days. How the 4 days are divided. So today it will be an introduction to CGE modeling with the macro and microeconomic tools that we need for modeling. After tomorrow, we're going to see a very quick introduction to GAMS, and then we will build the first model of CGE. Then the third day, we will extend all the other models by improving, I mean, the complexity of this basic model by adding, for instance, a second sector, and then adding the government, adding the rest of the world, and so on. And finally, we're going to have an introduction to dynamic modeling. So that's the fourth day, and how we can introduce some dynamics in CGE modeling. In general, in CGE workshops, we have two approaches. Either I show you an introduction to CGE modeling, and then I show you a realistic model taken from a real economy with a real code, with real data. But the problem of this approach is that you cannot really understand all the technical details and all the theoretical underpinnings of the model. So that's why, in general, I prefer the second approach, where it's a much more gradual approach. We start with a very basic model that you write, so you write the full code on GAMS. And this helps you really understand how GAMS works, what kind of errors we get, all this. And then building on this basic model, we extend the model by adding a second sector, which is the simple model. And then we add the government, and then we add the rest of the world. all these models are fictitious models. They do not deal with real data. But the advantage of this approach that I prefer and that I in general adopt in all the trainings I do for CGE modeling is that you really understand all the theoretical, empirical, and technical details of the model. And this helps you later build your own model, because at the end of the day, we will see when I will show you one of the models I did for the Egyptian economy, is that it's basically based on the models I will show you during the workshops, but it's just a more complicated or a more complete version of those basic models that we will see in the CGE. So this gradual approach takes time, but it really help have modelers, not just people who press on some buttons in order to get the results of some simulations. Because the problem of the first approach, if you just press on a button to get the results of a certain simulation, whenever you have any kind of error codes or syntax or errors in the syntax of the code itself, you'll not really be able to resolve this problem. So that's why we'll adopt the gradual approach that is time consuming, because we understand all the technical details and the theoretical, underpinnings of the model, but it's more robust from my perspective. And that's what we'll do during the 4 days. So every day we're going to have two lectures with a break between the two lectures. It's a hands-on training. So in most of the days, except today, we're going to see first some theory, and then we apply the theory on GAMS to have this balance between understanding the theory and apply the theory on a more practical or a more hands-on training for CGE modeling. Other than that, you will receive all the material, and you will receive a folder that includes three subfolders. So the first subfolder includes all the GAMS codes that we will work on during the 4 days, but you will receive this code at the end, because it's important that you develop your own code during the training workshop and to resolve the errors that you get in GAMS. You will receive a second subfolder where you will have all the slides of the 4 days. And finally, the last subfolder that includes all the references that we need for this workshop. So Ramaj Nada will send you all this by the end of the workshop, all the material. And given that we were going to build each model on the previous model that we do, at the end of each day, I will send you the correct version of the model just to compare your code with my code and to build the following day on what we have done the first day. Okay? So that's the overview of what we'll be doing and some logistics. Any comments? Any questions before we start? Okay, so if we don't have any questions, then I will start with the general introduction before the break, and then we start the more theoretical, I would say, things. So the objective of the first lecture is to show you what are the main characteristics of a CGE model. So I will go through seven main points. I will just present the general idea of CGE models, how we can define them, why shall we use, general equilibrium models compared to partial equilibrium models. Then what are the benefits and the drawbacks of CGE models? How a CGE model works? Then what is the theory upon which the CGE literature is based, which is the the Valorant, mainly the Valorant law? And finally, what are the steps that we need in order to build a CGE model? So those are mainly the 7 points that we'll cover during the first session before the break. And then after the break, we start the micro and macro refreshments for CGE modeling. And starting Wednesday, we start working on GAMS itself, okay? So as you know, CGE models, they stand for Computable General Equilibrium Models. And each word has a role in what we do in CGE models. So it's computable because we can calculate these models, they can be computed. Computed using what? Using national accounts data and especially the social accounting matrix. And we will see later what does a social accounting matrix look like, how we can construct the social accounting matrix, what are the sources of data for a social accounting matrix. But we'll not have time to build our own social accounting matrix. But I will refer to some sources that can show you how you can build your own social accounting matrix. Then it's general, not partial. And by general, we mean that we focus on the whole economy, all sectors, all agents, all institutions, all markets. Then it's equilibrium, meaning that we assume that we have an equilibrium on all markets. So it's not a disequilibrium model. And this is important because it's as we will see later, it's based on the law of Valras. And finally, it's a model, meaning that it's a system of equations. And we can see that the system of equations can go from 8 equations to thousands of equations. So in a nutshell, we're going to have a system of equations that represent a certain economy. This economy is in equilibrium, and we have to study all the institutions, agents, sectors, factors of production, goods, everything, okay? And in order to concretely measure this, we rely on social accounting metrics in order to make the model computable, as I said. Okay. Any questions so far? If you don't have any questions, please either raise your hand or send a question in the chat box, or just activate your camera and ask the question. This table is very important because it compares the CGE methodology to the econometric methodology. In general, CGE models are ex ante, meaning that we can use them before we run a certain, we implement a certain policy. So for instance, if the Egyptian government decides to reduce oil subsidies, then before reducing the oil subsidies, we want to quantify the impact of this policy. That's why it's ex ante before we have the policy change. But for the econometric analysis in general, it's ex post, meaning that we already have some historical data on some variables, and we determine the link between or the association between these variables through an econometric model. The second difference between CGE models and econometric modeling is that, as you know, in econometrics, in general, we run regressions. So we estimate some parameters from the regressions, and that's why we have regression estimation. In CGE models, we don't have any kind of estimation. We do not estimate because we simulate. And simulation is different because, in this case, what we'll do is that we will try to replicate the economy. So we try to replicate the economy without any policy change, and that's what we call the benchmark equilibrium or the business as usual, the BAU, B-A-U. And we try to see how the economy deviates from this equilibrium once we have a policy change. So that's why we do not really estimate any kind of regressions. The third difference between CGE models and econometric modeling. Okay, so there is a question from Ibrahim. is the baseline model that we start with in a CGE equilibrium. The baseline model is the model itself without a shock. So once we introduce the shock to the model, for instance, we have the Syrian economy, that's the initial status, where we have the current equilibrium of the economy. And let's assume that the Syrian government would like to reduce oil subsidies. We don't have the situation of the economy with this new equilibrium where subsidies are low. So that's why you want to imagine what we call a counterfactual. A counterfactual is a scenario that doesn't exist, but we want to imagine what the economy would be once we reduce these subsidies. And that's why at the end, I'm going to compare this counterfactual with the policy change with the baseline scenario or the benchmark or the business as usual that represents the economy without a shock. Is that clear? Ibrahim? Okay. So the third difference between CGE models and Karim.
Would you possible tell us where the CGE modeling is like standing out when comparing to econometric modeling? I'm highlighting here the idea that, okay, in econometrics, we have some kind of structural model. Why I need CGE modeling to move from the basic econometrics or even the complex econometrics techniques to some heavy calculated heavy math technique like the CGE model. I know there's some reason to use it. If you just like highlight it, and where's the most application for the CGE modeling? Thank you.
I didn't get the question. Compared to econometric modeling, you say?
No, compared to like more structural modeling, econometric technique. I'm referring here to when you are saying in the fourth point that we have identification problem in econometrics.
No, I will come to the fourth point. No, we stayed in the third one. So I will compare later the difference of identification with respect. I mean, in CGE modeling compared to econometrics. So I will come to this in a few minutes. But the third difference between econometrics and CGE modeling is that in general, in econometrics, either we have a simultaneous system of equations where we estimate simultaneously, for instance, a supply and demand function along with some other functions related to the market that we can estimate simultaneously using, for instance, seemingly unrelated regressions or a 2SLS estimation, all this. And the common factor between all these methods is that we estimate, okay, based on a certain sample, the simultaneous system of equations. But for CGE modeling, as I said, we do not estimate. So that's why we have two types of equations. We have first some behavioral equations, and we have some accounting relationships. What is the difference between the two types of equations? So first, just a second, I'll just plug the mouse. So for the accounting relationships, as you know, the most basic and the most well-known accounting relationship is the one where we have y that is equal to c plus I plus g plus x minus m. So we call this relationship an accounting relationship because at the end of the day, it's an identity. So it's an accounting identity where the left-hand side by definition is equal to the right-hand side. So we have a whole set of equations in CGE models that are accounting relationships. And at the same time, the second type of relationships that we have in CGE models is the behavioral equations. And for behavioral equations, they mainly deal with either maximization or minimization of profit maximization, utility maximization, cost minimization, and so on. And for instance, we have some equations like production. If we assume that it's a Cobb-Douglas production function, then we have y that is equal, for instance, a k alpha and l 1 minus alpha. So here, that's a Cobb-Douglas production function where we have y, which is production, a, which is the technology parameter, k, which is capital, and l, that is labor. So in this case, in order to get the value of capital and labor, or the optimal value, we have to maximize this relationship. And in this case, we call it a behavioral equation. Okay? So that's the difference between national accounts and or accounting relationships and behavioral equations. The fourth difference between econometric modeling and CGE modeling is the fact that econometrics in general rely on data, meaning that the larger the sample, the more reliable our findings, because we know that the larger the sample for in any kind of econometric regressions, this will increase the degrees of freedom, and this will mean that we can have more robust estimators. For CGE modeling, as I said, we don't have any kind of estimation, but we have some benchmark data. So we don't, our CGE model does not really depend on data size, because at the end of the day, we just have one type of data, which is the social accounting matrix. And that's why it does not really rely on data, but we just need data for our benchmark scenario. And that's the fourth difference. The fifth difference between both is that in econometrics, the most important problem is identification. And by identification, I mean how we can identify the cause and effect relationship and how the model can be correctly specified in order to really determine what is the effect of a certain variable on another variable. So that's for the identification issue in econometrics. The counterpart of identification in CGE modeling is related to the forms of equation. Because in general, for instance, in any econometric modeling, we need to double check that we don't have any kind of endogenous relationship, for instance. But in CGE models, it's not a matter of endogeneity because we're not estimating. And in this case, we would not like to get biased or unbiased estimators because there are no estimations by any means. But at the same time, the choice of the form of equations affects my results, meaning that am I going to choose a Cobb-Douglas production function or a constant elasticity of substitution? Are we going to have a constant elasticity of transformation or a constant elasticity of substitution, and so on? So in all these cases, we have to choose the form of equations in order to make sure that it is in line with the characteristics of the economy we have. After we run a regression in econometric models, in general, we run some robustness checks, like the Dwight test, Hausman test, and over-identification test, all these kind of tests we need to run after we run an econometric model or we run a regression. In CGE models, we don't have specific econometric tests that equivalent to what we do in econometrics. But what we do, we run some sensitivity analysis. And the sensitivity analysis deals with two things mainly. It deals with the key parameters and the form of equations, as I've said. So the key parameters that I have in the model, the elasticity of substitution, the elasticity of transformation, the wage elasticity, all that, I can change the values of the parameters and see whether the results, they change a lot, they don't change, they are robust, and so on. That's on the one hand. On the other, what also affects my results is the macroeconomic closure. And the macroeconomic closure is a very important concept in CGE modeling, because macroeconomic closure shows what are the assumptions that we have in our model, and that will help me have a final equilibrium. So for instance, I can assume that exchange rate is a constant, meaning that it's a short-term economy and the exchange rate will remain constant in the short term. But I can assume that the exchange rate is not constant and it's the share of current account to GDP that is constant. So the choice of constant versus unconstant variables is what we call the macroeconomic closure. And in general, the change in key parameters and the change in the form of equations, whether they are Cobb-Douglas cost elasticity of substitution, of transformation, and so on, these two types of changes, they do not affect the outcome of a CGE modeling or of a CGE model. But the change in the macroeconomic closure is fundamental because it can affect, it can significantly affect the results of the simulation. Okay? The final point between econometrics and CGE models is that econometrics in general are not really suitable to analyze or to have some welfare analysis. Meaning that if I want to examine the direct and indirect effects of a certain shock on the economy, I cannot use econometrics because econometrics in general, they are more of partial equilibrium models. But the idea, the importance of CGE modeling is that they can show how a certain policy can have some direct and indirect effects on the economy. And at the end of the day, I can say whether at the macro level, the welfare has improved or has deteriorated. Okay? So those are the main differences between what about SVAR model are not, they measure the impact of the shocks on economic variables. This is a very important question, actually. Thank you, Brahim. So Brahim is asking, what about the structural VAR models? In general, they measure the impact of shocks on economic variables. So SVAR, which are the structural vector autoregressive models. So those models, compared to CGE models, we have at least three differences. First, while SVAR models, they rely on an estimation method, CGE models, they do not rely on an estimation method because we do computations, not estimations. That's the first difference. The second difference, the SVAR model does not take into consideration all the interrelations between different sectors, for in the backward and forward linkages between sectors, for instance. It does not take into consideration some specific, I would say, institutions in the economy, because in general, it's very macro. So it shows what happens for consumption, investment, money supply. I mean, all the equations that represent the economy at the macro level, but that do not take into consideration the differences at the factors of production, the differences at the products, and at the economic agents levels. And finally, for the SVAR, as you know, in order to run a structural VAR model, you have to assume what is the order of from the most exogenous variable to the least exogenous variable. We don't need to do that in the CGE literature. So those are the main differences between SVAR and the CGE models, bearing in mind that SVAR models can be used to analyze to have what we call some impulse response functions and factor variance decomposition after we run the regression in order to see how a certain variable reacts to the other variable. But again, it is based on an estimation method, which is not the case in CGE modeling. Is that clear? Okay, other questions before we continue to the next part? Okay, so if we don't have any questions, then how can we define a CGE model? So a CGE model, as you can see here in the slide, it's an analytical approach that helps us analyze a certain economy with all its institutions. And by institutions, I mean the institutions that are identified in the system of national accounts, where we have industries, household, factors of production, government, rest of the world, and so on. And for CGE models in general, we look at the interdependence of different variables, meaning that if price increases, how consumption is affected, and when consumption is affected, how production is affected, and when production is affected, how the demand for labor and capital, for instance, is affected. And this is important, why? Because if we have any shock in the economy, the rest of the economy will be affected by this shock. Why? Because all the agents and markets, they are interrelated somehow. So I cannot really assume that when we have a certain shock, that one of the markets is in equilibrium and the other is in disequilibrium. In the CGE literature, we assume that we have a representative producer or a representative consumer. And as I said, it's computable because it shows a system that provides a quantitative analysis of a certain policy shock, where we use the social accounting matrix. From your perspective, why shall we rely on a CGE model, not a partial equilibrium model? So if you have any ideas, please go ahead. Why shall we use partial equilibrium, CGE models and not partial equilibrium models? What do you think? So what do you think? Why shall we rely on CGE models and not partial equilibrium models?
Using partial equilibrium, maybe we don't consider the effect of other factors, but CGE, I think, is a more general calculation, like considering all the effect of, all the factors. Partial equilibrium, I think, is just focusing on the impact of one factor, I think.
Exactly. So CGE models, they take into consideration the effect of a certain shock on different parts of the economy, not just one part. What else? What do you think? Any insights?
Yeah, I mean, in CGE, I think we analyze all the relationships altogether, like relationship with the household and the firms and the government and
exactly
the rest of the world. But partial equilibrium, I think, we don't see all these relationships.
Exactly. So in CGE models, we look at the different, what we call in the vocabulary of national accounts, different institutions. So I look at the interaction between households, government, firms, rest of the world, and so on. What else? Why shall we use CGE models and not partial equilibrium models? What do you think? Why are CGE models in some cases better than partial equilibrium models?
Do you think it's because of the unobservables?
We cannot really talk about unobservables here because in general, unobservables, they are controlled for instance, in an econometric regression through some fixed effects. Here, I'm assuming that I'm observing all the economy. So I'm taking into consideration all the economic flows that I have in the economy.
So when we talk about the CG, we don't have any unobservable. So we don't assume, okay.
What else? Why shall we rely on a CGE model, not partial equilibrium model? What do you think?
Can I say, but I'm not sure. But what I understand is that we can have only one data set to work on it, not multi data set or time series data sets. I'm not sure, but.
No, please say it again.
Because I can measure or calculate or determine the problem in one data set, using one data set only. Not many data sets or time series data sets.
You will just need, as you said, the social accounting matrix only. You will not need a long time series, for instance, because if you want to estimate a system of demand and supply of a certain good, then we will need a long time series for the demand and supply of this good.
Yes, that's what I meant.
And this can be demanding to some extent. But for CGE models, we just need the SAM. What else in terms of the differences between CGE models and partial equilibrium models? What do you think? So I'm... Okay, so Nadine Ala Dusui is saying that it might be overcoming data problems. Yes, and that's similar to the point that was raised by Nesma. What other points? So in general, one of the most important things in CGE models compared to partial equilibrium models is that, and this was mentioned, we can examine the economy-wide impact analysis for a certain economy, and in general, we distinguish between different types of models. So we have what we call global multinational models, and we can have single country models. So for the multinational models, there are some models that show if we have a shock in a certain economy, how the other economies are affected by this shock, okay? So for instance, if we assume that we're trying to simulate the effect of a new, for instance, the new African Continental Free Trade Agreement that includes almost all the African countries in the African continent, then in this case, we're examining what happens if South Africa removes its tariffs, how the rest of Africa will be affected. And we can even examine how the rest of the world will be affected and what happens if Egypt does the same thing, if Mauritania does the same thing, and so on. So the economy-wide impact analysis, we can study this either through multinational models where I divide the whole world into some regions, that's on the one hand, or I can use also single country models, and single country models, they focus on a specific country with more details. So in this case, I will have my national economy, which is in my case, for instance, Egypt or Jordan or Lebanon, and I will examine how the Egyptian economy is affected by a certain policy shock that takes place either in Egypt or in the rest of the world. So in the case of single country models, I have a country vis-a-vis the rest of the world, but in multinational models, I have all the regions of the world or all the countries of the world that, that are included in the model. Clearly, given that we are examining also the economy-wide impact analysis, so in this case, we can study the backward and forward linkages between sectors. And this is also important because I can, if for instance, we decide to reduce the oil subsidies, then oil subsidies clearly will not affect an energy intensive sector. In a similar way, like an energy, like a sector that does not, that is not intensive in energy, for instance. So for instance, I can have the cement sector and I have the garment sector. These two sectors, they will not be equally affected by the tariff, by the subsidy removal, because the cement sector is much more energy intensive and is and consequently will be much more affected by the shock than the garments industry. Then the second point is that CGE models, they help also trace the distributional impact of any policy that we have in the economy. Because in this case, I will be able to compare wages to rents. So I will compare capital owners with households, for instance. I can compare different quantiles of households, how the richest quantile is affected by a shock compared to the lowest quantile. And this show me how a certain policy shock will have a redistribution between different economic agents. The third point is that CGE models, they also have a broad scope because I take into consideration everything, as I said, different institutions, different households, production sectors, different goods, and so on. And they can tackle a wide range of topics, ranging from tax policy, trade policy, environmental issues, what happens if we impose, for instance, a tax, a carbon tax, what happens if we reduce energy subsidies, if we remove tariffs on imports, if we remove non-tariff measures. So they can really address different things. The only thing that cannot be studied in a CGE framework is monetary policy. Why? Because CGE models are real models. And by real models, I mean that they mainly deal with the real sector, not the financial sector or the nominal sector. And that's why if we want to study monetary policy, in this case, we have to use something like the DSGE model, the dynamic stochastic general equilibrium models, which is a different literature, different assumptions and different methodology. The same, I would say, rationale, but the details are really different. So those are the first main points that show why we shall we use a general equilibrium model compared to a partial equilibrium model. In addition to all that, partial equilibrium models, in general, they focus on a specific market and they focus on the direct effects of a certain shock. Meaning that if the price of a certain good increases, then the demand for this good is going to decrease, and that's the direct effect. But I cannot really examine what are the indirect effects associated to this decrease in the demand of this good. But I can do this in a general equilibrium model. Another important point is that partial equilibrium models, they do not capture income effects endogenously. And what does this mean? It means that I cannot really examine the link between factor incomes and their expenditure. But I can do this in a general equilibrium model because I will see the link between what, for instance, households get and how they spend their money. Okay? And one final point is that in partial equilibrium models also, I do not look into the interactions between markets, because definitely the goods market interact with the factors of production market, with the services market, and so on. And I cannot really address this through the partial equilibrium models. What are the benefits and drawbacks of CGE models? So the main benefits of CGE models in general, perhaps you have heard, I mean, you heard that before, CGE models are generally accused of being a black box or garbage in, garbage out. But in general, I strongly believe that this accusation is not really well founded, because it's one of the rare methods that are fully dependent on the micro and macro theory, meaning that CGE models, they have a theoretical consistency in the sense that they are based on the producer theory, the consumer theory, and the macroeconomic theory in Keynesian words or in classical words, meaning that we have some relationships that belong to the short term in the Keynesian economy. And we'll see also how we have some elements from growth theories, for instance, that are more neoclassical. So in terms of the theoretical consistency, they are very theoretical, based on theoretical tools. And in terms of accounting consistency, given the fact that they depend on, or they use social accounting matrices, then such social accounting matrices, in order to use them in any CGE model, they must be fully balanced. And given the fact that social accounting matrices are fully balanced, this means that I would depart from a status where the economy is in an equilibrium status. So that's why we have an accounting consistency where we have a balanced sum, and in a balanced sum, all the expenditures are equal to the incomes that we have in the economy. So expenditure cannot exceed income. We have a theoretical consistency that is based on the micro and macro theory, and especially the law of Walras. And perhaps you heard about the law of Walras that says that if we have n markets, so if let's say we have 10 markets, and n minus 1 markets are in equilibrium, so 9 markets are in equilibrium, then this last market, by definition, must be also in equilibrium. And this what guarantees the fact that all the economic flows will circulate within the economy and will not have any outflow that does not have a counterpart in the economy. That's why, back again to the theoretical consistency, in general, we have the supply that is equal to the demand. Firms, they maximize their profit, meaning that given that we have a perfect competition framework, we have a zero profit condition for firms that has to be satisfied. And finally, even households, they maximize their utility subject to the budget constraint. And that's what I was talking about in terms of the behavioral equations that we have in this model. Okay. So that's the first and very important benefit of CGE models. The second important benefit is that they can really measure the backward and forward linkages between different sectors. Because I have within the social accounting matrix the input-output table, and within the input-output table, I can really examine which sector is more dependent on the other sectors. And that's why I can really examine which sector will be much more affected than other sectors. It can help me also have some welfare analysis, as I said, because I will see what is the net effect of a certain shock at the national level. In terms of data requirements, it's not data consuming because we use in general the social accounting matrix only, not a long time series. And finally, in order, given the fact that, as I said in the beginning, for CGE models, we reason in terms of the representative agent. So in the case of CGE models, I can also take into consideration the heterogeneity that I have among individuals. So I will not reason in terms of a representative agent, but I will reason in terms of different individuals, and I can replicate the macro shock at the micro level in order to see how different agents with different characteristics will be affected by that. And that's what we call a micro simulation. Okay? In terms of the drawbacks of CGE models, we can have some difficulties in choosing the models, the parameters, the functional form that I will adopt in a specific model, whether I will adopt a Cobb-Douglas production function or a constant elasticity of substitution model. And then we have also a problem that pertains to the data consistency, because constructing a social accounting matrix is not an easy task and can be time consuming. That's why in some cases we cannot really sustain the updateness of the model in order to make it really up to date and compliant with the recent developments that we have in the economy. I would say a cost of maintaining the model up to date. Then we don't have any kind of, like in econometrics, any formal tests that help us determine whether the model is sensitive or not. But as I said, the only option that we have is to run some sensitivity analysis by changing the values of the parameters, by changing the functional forms, by changing the macro closure, and seeing how my results change. They are not good for monetary issues, as I said, because they are real models. For fiscal policies, it depends, because I cannot really use CGE models to examine the evolution of debt, because debt is a financial variable. But I can use CGE models to examine the effect of imposing a value-added tax or removing subsidies. And those aspects, they are related to the fiscal policy. So those are the main benefits and drawbacks of CGE models. Any questions on that so far? No questions, everything is clear. Okay, so what is the mechanism of CGE? That's just a reminder of what you have seen at the undergrad level in an introduction to macroeconomics, which is the circular flow of the economy, where we have four agents. So we have here firms, we have rest of the world, we have households, and we have the government. Okay, so those are the four agents that we have. We have two markets. We have the factor market and the goods market. Then each institution will have two types of flows, either real flows that deal with goods or financial flows that deal with money or with the cost of this real flow. So for instance, here we have, let's take the example of households. So households, they will provide their services in the form of factors of production to the factor market. And then the factor market will give to the firms those factors of production, whether labor or capital. Firms will use these factors of production in order to produce some goods, what we have here, and these goods will be consumed by households. So here I'm talking about real flows of goods or factors of production. But for instance, the government will impose on the goods market some taxes. It can also provide some subsidies, like the bread subsidies, for instance, that we have in some countries, or the oil subsidies that we have in some countries. And at the same time, the factors market will also benefit from some transfers from the government. They will pay some taxes. For the goods market with the rest of the world, we have the goods market that goes to the rest of the world, where we have here exports, and then imports that come from the rest of the world to the goods market. And finally, we have the foreigners here that will receive and that will send remittances. Okay, so that's the general idea of the circular flow that we model in a CGE framework. Any question on this before I continue? Anything that's not clear? Okay, so what is the structure of a CGE model? So this is a very simple graph that shows first that we combine factors of production, so labor and capital, with intermediate inputs in order to produce some goods, okay? That's the production. Then in order to combine the factors of production with intermediate inputs, they are combined either through a Cobb-Douglas production function, through a constant elasticity of substitution production function, and so on. Once we produce, these goods can be either consumed at the domestic level or exported to the rest of the world. And we combine them through what we call a constant elasticity of transformation function, the CET function. So the constant elasticity of transformation function is a function that show, we will see this with more details later, but just to give you an idea, that shows that exports and domestic products are imperfect substitutes. For instance, if I produce some shirts in Egypt, in order to make them exportable, I have, for instance, to translate the labels of the shirt. So this is a cost that I have to bear in order to make my product exportable. So those are the CET functions that we frequently use in CGE models. So my production will be either exported or consumed domestically. Then in the domestic market, my domestic products will be combined with imports. The difference between exports and imports represents the trade balance. Then imports will be combined with domestic products in order to have domestically the total supply of goods, okay, that comes either from domestic producers or from the rest of the world. And these goods will be consumed either by households or by the government or by firms in form of the investment goods or by other sectors that will use these goods in order to produce other goods. And this intermediate inputs will be combined with factors of production in order to produce some goods and so on. So that's the idea of a CGE model. So basically, what we try to do in a CGE model is to formally or to mathematically represent all those interrelations between different institutions, different markets, and different economic aggregates. Any questions? Anything, any comment, anything that's not clear? Okay, so for the theory and the Vallaras law, I will go, I present this quickly because I assume that you're familiar with that. So as I said, CGE models are based on the law of Vallaras, who published in the 19th century, the competitive general equilibrium. And the important thing about this contribution of Valras is that he showed how we can formally or mathematically represent an economy. And that was the first, I would say, formal model that we have in economics. What Valras said in his book is that this, he said that the sum of the values of excess demand across all markets must equal zero. Why? Because if we have an excess in one market, it has to be compensated by another market. And in general, this means that if I have a positive excess in one market, I must have a negative excess in another market, which means that at the end of the day, if I have n markets and n minus one markets are in equilibrium, consequently, the last market must be also in equilibrium. And that's the fundamental idea of what we do. It can be criticized because in general, several markets cannot be in equilibrium. But again, we're trying to think in terms of ceteris paribus, meaning that what happens for the economy if we maintain everything else that is held constant, what happens for the economy, for a specific variable itself. And that's why this last market will be redundant, because I will not need the last market as long as I have n minus one markets that are in equilibrium. Any questions? So the final thing we'll do before the break is just a second, there is a question. Yes, the slides will be shared. So what are the steps of a CGE model? First, what we do is that we get the data that we need for a CGE model. And these data are either the input-output table that we get from the statistical agency, and then we build our own CGE model. Then we build our own social accounting matrix, or we get the social accounting matrix directly from the statistical institute or from the ministry or from agency within the country. We have to do some adjustments depending on our research question, because for instance, I can have 20 service sector and the 10 manufacturing sector, while in my analysis, I just need to focus on the manufacturing sector. Then in this case, I will not need all the details I have in the services sector. I can combine them in one sector, in two sectors, and that's what I mean by data adjustment. Okay. Once my data set is ready, once the SAM is ready, I proceed with the calibration, and I will explain the calibration in the next session. Okay, it's the inverse of estimation, and the idea of calibration very quickly shows how I can calculate the value of parameters. So I calculate the value of parameters. I determine which variables are exogenous and which variables are endogenous in my model, and this has to be identified based on the characteristics of the economy, based on the literature, and based on what I want to do in my model. After the calibration and the specification of exogenous values, the first important thing, I do a replication check. What is a replication check? It's the fact that I replicate my economy through my model. Because if my model I built is able to reproduce the economy I have, then in this case, I can use it in order to simulate, to run any kind of simulation. But if the model is not able to reproduce the same economy without a shock, then I cannot use this model to do any kind of simulation. So that's why I have first to do the replication check. We will go through all these steps empirically, but I'm just providing you with the general overview of what we'll do. And then once I'm sure that my model is able to reproduce the initial status of the economy, I can produce what we call the benchmark equilibrium, meaning that's the status of the economy without any shock. Then I introduce the shock. Once I introduce the shock, I obtain the counterfactual equilibrium, meaning that it's the new equilibrium with the shock, and we call it counterfactual because it doesn't exist in reality. Then I will compare the economy with and without shock. I can run some policy, some other simulations, and then I finish the analysis. So those are the different steps of CGE models. There is one question from Hassan. What type of simulation CGE models could perform, stochastic, deterministic, or both? In the CGE models that we'll see, or in general, CGE models are deterministic. They are not stochastic. DSGE models are stochastic. But here, all our relationships are deterministic. Any other questions on the introduction? Okay, so just a couple of announcements. First, you will get all the material, the slides, the recordings, and the references. So the recordings will be available on the website of ERF. The slides, the codes, and the papers, you will receive them. Ramaj will send them to you. Now, if we don't have any more questions, we'll have our coffee break. In general, this is a pleasant moment where we have some cakes and coffees at ERF, but now we'll just have some virtual coffee on our own. So now it's 5:30. We will resume in 15 minutes. So we start at 5:45. Okay, I will not close the session. You can just turn off your camera and mic, and we'll resume in 15 minutes. Okay. Hello, everyone. We can start the second session. Any general questions on what I've presented in the first session on the...
Sorry, Zahir, I just had a question, but just before the break, can you have a look at the chat box?
Just a second, yes. So are we going to see how to establish SAM using Computable? No, we'll not be able to do this because, because we have a very short workshop.
Can you suggest?
But I can send you some references that show you how we can construct a SAM from the input-output table.
Okay, thank you so much. If you can send them, I
sure,
will be happy.
Will do.
Thanks.
Other questions? Okay. Okay, now we can present the main macro. So the main macro tools that we need for CGE modeling. There is a question from Ibrahim. It's not clear why we cannot use CGE model for monetary policy and fiscal policy. Yes. So as I said, we can use it for fiscal policy, but not for monetary policy. Why not for monetary policy? Because monetary policy, by definition, is or it belongs to the nominal or to the financial sector. And CGE models are real models. So they deal with real aggregates, like investment, like exports, imports, consumption, any aggregate that is real. So that's why CGE models, given the fact that they deal with the real sector, so they have to deal with policies that deal with the real sector, like fiscal policy, decrease in taxes, decrease in subsidies, tariff removal, and so on, environmental policies like the carbon tax, the trade policies, increasing non-tariff measures, decreasing tariffs, all that we can use. But given that monetary policy deals mainly with nominal variables. We cannot use them in, we cannot simulate them in a CGE model. Is that clear? Okay. So the next hour, I will present the main macroeconomic concepts that we need to understand CGE models, and that we'll be using after tomorrow when we start working with GAMS. So I will present a brief introduction, then how we can measure growth from different perspectives, because this is important as we do this in a CGE model. Then the a fundamental issue in modeling, which is the difference between volumes and values. Then the structure of social accounting matrices, the idea of calibration. And if we have time, I will present the social accounting matrix of Egypt. If not, then we can see it next week. Okay. So in general, if we divide macroeconomic theory, it can be divided into two main strands. The first strand is the Keynesian strand, and the second one is the classical and neoclassical one. The Keynesian strand mainly focuses on demand, because demand is the main driver of the economy, and that's why Keynes introduced the concept of aggregate demand, and how after the Great Depression, in order to recover from the depression, we need expansionary policies that will mainly affect the demand, not the supply. But for the classics, it was they were more focusing on the supply side, not the demand side. And that's why, for instance, one of the economists who was Jean-Baptiste Say, who said that the supply creates its own demand. That's why what matters in the economy is the supply, not the demand. The Keynesian economy focuses, or the Keynesian macroeconomics focuses on the short run. Because as you know, Keynes said, in the long run, we are all dead. And that's why, given the fact that in the long run, we're all dead, we have to focus on the short run. And if you want to recover the economy, we have to boost the short run. As per classical macroeconomics, it was focusing more on the long run. And the steady state that we can achieve in the long run. One final difference between both is that in the Keynesian macro, given the fact that we are focusing on the short run, so prices are rigid. And if prices are rigid, then in this case, the adjustment will take place through quantities. But for classics, given the fact that we are in the long run, so prices are flexible, and if prices are flexible, then the quantities will remain constant at their steady state. So that's mainly, the different strands that we have in macro between Keynesian and classics macroeconomics. And we will see that CGE models, they have some elements from the Keynesian macroeconomics and some elements from the neoclassical models, okay? In order to measure growth, that's just a very quick reminder of what you have seen in different undergrad courses, because this is really the basic elements that we need for CGE models. You know that we can measure GDP either from a flow of product approach or from an income, earnings, or cost approach. And in theory, the three approaches from a national accounting perspective, they have to converge to the same values. And that's why, regardless the way we measure GDP, we should get the same value. And that's why we will see in the CGE model, when I will calculate the GDP as the sum of the different value added of different sectors, or the sum of remuneration of different factors, or the sum of demand components like consumption plus investment plus government spending plus exports minus imports, all this shall converge to the same value. So the expenditure approach, it's a method of computing GDP that measures of total amount spent on all final goods and services during a given period, which means that clearly that the GDP is a flow, not a stock. And for the income approach, it's a method of computing GDP that measures the income, wages, rents, interest, profits received by the different factors of production in order to produce the same goods and services included in the first definition. For the expenditure approach, it's very simple, and you know that, I mean this formula where GDP is equal to C plus I plus G plus X minus M. In a closed economy framework, we can remove the exports minus imports. And we will see that in the basic model that we will derive first, we'll assume that my GDP without government, the G disappears. Without rest of the world, the export minus imports disappear. And without savings, the investment disappears, which means that at the end of the day, the GDP will be equal to consumption. Okay? For the income approach, so the total income here, we look at the income that is earned by different factors of production. And in general, in most of the social accounting matrices that we will see, we have two factors of production, labor and capital. So the sum of remuneration of labor that is employed in different sectors and the sum of capital that is employed in different sectors as well, we get the total value added, which is the GDP. Okay, those are some minor refinements that you can read in the slides on the differences between different types of incomes, the personal income versus the national income versus the net national income, the gross national income, all this. And clearly the two important keywords that we have in this is the word net versus gross, and national versus domestic. And you know that net versus gross is whether I take into consideration or not the depreciation, and domestic versus national is whether I focus on the territory, which is the case of domestic, and national if I focus on the nationality, not the territory. So for instance, if I want to calculate the gross national product, then in this case, I have to add, sorry, if I calculate the GDP, it's the gross domestic product, meaning everything I produce on the domestic territory, regardless the nationality of those who produce. But if I want to calculate the GNP, the gross national product, in this case, I have to add remittances from the rest of the world and subtract remittances to the rest of the world. So that's just a very quick reminder of those different concepts, because you will need them in when we write the code. And then we have the disposable income, which is the personal income minus direct taxes. We have the personal savings that are defined as the difference between the disposable income and my consumption. And here, this will depend on the propensity of the propensity to consume or to save, and the savings rate, which is the share of savings to income. So that's the summary of the different measures that we will see in a CGE model. We start with the GDP at factor cost, that is the sum of value added. If we add indirect taxes, we get the GDP at market price. If we add remittances from the rest of the world minus remittances to the rest of the world, we get the GNP. If we subtract the depreciation, we get the net national product. If we get out the statistical discrepancy, we get the national income. If we get out the income that does not go to household, we get the personal income. And then from the personal income, if we get out the taxes, we get the disposable income. From the disposable income, if we get out the interest payments and the transfers made by the household, we get finally the personal savings. So all these macro aggregates are needed in order to understand the general overview of the CGE model and how different aggregates are linked to each other and how a shock that happens in one of these aggregates will affect the others, okay? Here an important question. In general, the social accounting matrix is in current or in constant Egyptian pounds. What do you think? Not Egyptian pounds, I mean in general, in constant or in current prices. What do you think? So as Karim and Abdul, it's Abdulillah, is that correct? Okay, so like Karim and Abdulillah said, it's in current prices, not in constant prices. Does this, I mean, if you want to answer, you can just turn on your mic to make the session more interactive, because currently it's just, I mean, a one-way monologue, so we can make it more interactive. And in general, does the difference between current and constant prices matter if we have just 1 year, which is the year of the social accounting matrix? What do you think and why? If you have an idea, please turn on your mic. So I will ask the question once again. If we have 1 year in our data set, which is the year that we have in the social accounting matrix, does the difference between current and constant prices matter or not? And why? Any insights?
Good evening, Shahir. Shahir, good evening.
Yes, good evening.
I'm not sure, but I think it could be an real because we are using really one year, but when we use the equilibrium, we deal with the national income. And I think it is in the real values, not in the nominal.
No, the social accounting matrix, it's correct. It's in current prices.
Current,
so it's in nominal terms, not in real terms.
But in equilibrium.
Sorry?
But in equilibrium.
Yes, we are still in with nominal figures.
Okay.
But now the question is, does it matter when we just have 1 year?
Not really.
Not exactly. It doesn't matter. Why? Because at the end of the day, I have 1 year, and we know that for the benchmark year, in general, nominal values are equal to constant values, or current prices are equal to constant prices are equal to current prices.
True. Yes.
But.
So change in prices will not affect because we are taking 1 year.
Exactly. Yeah. But the idea here is that, given the fact that CGE models,
I just say that because the current prices are calculated in real value, so they are adjusted for changes in the prices within a given period, especially in the short term. So.
No. That's not the case. If we have 1 year,
because this is what I'm saying. For 1 year, we do not have to worry about these issues because the short term there is no adjustment to be made.
There is no adjustment, yes. But the idea here is that we have a problem because the social accounting matrix is in current prices, which shows the values of my macroeconomic variables. What does this mean? It means that the number I have in the social accounting matrix shows the value of consumption, not the quantity of consumption. And why is that important from a CGE perspective? Because in general, we will see in the CGE literature that we have to distinguish between prices or quantities and values, or volume and value. Why is that? Because in CGE models, we have the variable itself and its price. In other words, I have in a CGE model, I have consumption and I have the price of consumption. What I have in the social accounting matrix is the value of consumption, and the value of consumption is the product of the price of consumption multiplied by the quantity of consumption, or the price of consumption multiplied by the value of consumption. So that's why at the end of the day, I have to take this into consideration. Why? Because in the because whenever I will run a simulation, so if I run any simulation, I will have two variables that will be affected differently. I will have, on the one hand, the quantities that are affected, and on the other, I will have also the prices that are affected. So how can we link this with the values that I have in the matrix that are in current prices? So we said that for the base year, it doesn't matter whether I have current or constant prices. But what matters is that I want to convert the values I have into volumes or quantities in order to distinguish the quantity effect from the price effect. Is this point clear? So this distinction between current versus constant and current versus constant and volume versus value, or volume or value versus quantity.
Dr. Shahir, I have like a comment, if I can speak now, Jan.
Sure.
Okay. Yes, I got your point. I was also thinking that, of course, if there is a shock to the system, I have to distinguish between affecting the prices and the quantities, or the consumption itself, or the prices like the CPI or something. But another point, I think you mentioned earlier that the model, the CGE model, could be used to reflect many economies or many countries, not just one country or not just one economy. So I guess it's better to also to distinguish between the quantities and the prices, because of course prices and the price index is not the same at different countries or in different countries, or I'm confusing things or what?
No, I mean, your point is correct, but this is, but in the case of multinational models, and we will see later how we do this in CGE models, if you remember, I said in that CGE models are real models. Given the fact that they are real models, prices in the model, or in other words, what matters in the model, it's not the value of the price, but it's more the relative price. What matters is not the level of the price, but the relative price, meaning that we will see later when we start coding on GAMS that we can assume that for the base year, okay, for the base year, all the prices are normalized to one, which is acceptable. Why? Because we said that in the base year, there is no difference between values and volumes, because it's the base year. So if I assume that all the prices are equal to one, we will see that once we run a certain simulation, okay, this one will become, for instance, 0.8. So what matters for me in a CGE model is the change in the relative price, because the change in the relative price, meaning the change in the price with respect to other prices, will lead to a change in the allocation of resources. Because if we assume that we're an economy and oil prices increased by 20%, oil prices, does this can this lead to a change in the allocation of resources? What do you think?
No, because
everything, all the prices, they changed proportionally. But the allocation of resources can change when relative prices change. And that's why at the end of the day, what matters for me in a CGE model is the change in relative prices that I will have in the model. So that's why I can normalize all the prices to one in the base year, run the shock, and see how relative prices change and consequently how my allocation of resources will change. So that's why even if even in a multinational model, back to Nadine's question, in a multinational model, we can assume that most of the prices are normalized in the base year, but then we will look at how relative prices change, for instance, with respect to a certain numeraire that we will choose. You know, the numeraire is the nominal variable with respect to which we express all the variables, right? So here, for instance, if you assume that my numeraire will be the exchange rate or the numeraire will be the producer price index, then in this case, I will express all the prices of the economy with respect to the producer price index or with respect to the exchange rate. So in a nutshell, what matters at the end of the day is the change in the relative price, not prices in absolute levels. And that's why we will see that we're going to normalize most of the prices in the base year, given the fact that in the base year, there is no difference between values and volumes.
Okay, thank you.
Is that clear?
Ah, yes, very clear. Thank you.
Any question?
Yes, please, I have a question. Does normalizing all the value of prices mean that all prices will have the value of one?
For the time being, I will say yes. Most of the prices are equal to one, with the exception of some prices that are subject to taxes based on my model. So if, for instance, there is a tax imposed on goods, or services, or if we have a tariff or if we have a tariff, then in this case I cannot assume, for instance, that import price is equal to one. Why? Because import price includes also the tax rate. But I will keep this for now, because we will see how this is tackled in different models later. But the short answer is that most of the prices, yes, are normalized to one.
Okay.
Other questions? Okay. So we have seen the argument of nominal versus real and how in order, in general, it's important to distinguish between current versus constant, nominal versus real, which is the same thing. In order to really be able to measure the increase in the GDP that is attributed to the change in quantities, not prices, and that's what measures economic growth. This is just an example. In CGE model, as I said, we have to normalize prices to one in order to convert the values of the sum into volumes. Then we choose a numeraire, which is the variable with respect to which we're going to express all the other prices. And the numeraire in a CGE model is either the exchange rate or the producer price index and so on. And only relative price matters. Okay. Any question on these three important points? Because those are fundamental later, when we're going to start to derive different models. Any questions? Okay. for social accounting matrices, it's one of the most important documents. So I think that Abdulillah and Kareem, probably, I don't remember, who said that you work with input-output tables and with potentially some social accounting matrices. Am I correct? So who said that he or she is working with social accounting matrices and input-output tables?
I work with supply and use tables. Also, output table. Rafa from Palestine.
Yes, okay.
Yes, so, it's true. I do work with input-output tables for Saudi Arabia.
Okay, so...
But I didn't work with specifically social accounting matrices.
Great. So,
but we do it here, you know, just to give you some background. We don't really... We have developed in CAPSAR, which is the King Abdullah Petroleum Studies for research, we developed our own methodology using some optimization techniques to balance the input-output table. We combine it with econometric techniques. So we actually forecasted IoT projections based on some governmental targets. So we do have a dynamic input-output table developed in-house. That's why I work with it a lot. But that is my perspective on it.
Great. And would you please elaborate more on the structure of an input-output table, because I will build on that?
Basically, I'm sure you know more, but an input-output table basically represents the dependence between sectors, how much sectors buy and sell from each other. It is usually conducted through traditional surveys every 5 years, presumably, in which sectors identify how much they buy from other sectors, and then it's also linked to a value added component and a final demand component.
Great.
And then from that table, we can start to utilize Leontief inverse matrix to compute technological coefficients, value added multipliers, income multipliers, and so on. I don't know if you want me to elaborate more.
Perfect. I mean, that's fine, and that's exactly what I wanted to say on input output tables. And in general, one of the important things that we have also to look at for input output tables is the amount of zeros. Because if we have a lot of zeros in the input output table, this means that the backward and forward linkages between sectors are low. And if they are low, this means that the domestic economy is not integrated. And this is one of the important things that we have to study when we look at a social accounting matrix, at an input-output table. The social accounting matrix is an extended input-output table in the sense that the input-output table is included in the social accounting matrix, and we call it social accounting matrix because it takes into consideration everything related to the society, and that's why we call it social accounting. It's a matrix because it has a number of rows that is equal to the number of columns. It's a square matrix. And it includes all the economic flows that you can have in mind, ranging from exports, imports, investment, consumption, savings, current account, fiscal deficit, input output, meaning backward and forward linkages, everything is included in the social accounting matrix. So that's why the social accounting matrix is a very comprehensive economy-wide data framework, which is it's a large Excel sheet that includes everything. And as I said, it's a square matrix. And in general, we read the matrix where each column pays the role. And I will come back to this later because this is important in understanding the dynamics of the CGE as well. So the CGE, in order to construct a CGE, in general, it's constructed from different sources. And there is no one rule for the number of cells that we have or the number of rows and columns that we have in a social accounting matrix. Why? Because it will depend on my research question. Okay. What does this mean? It means that, for instance, if Abdullah was just saying that he's working in a think tank that mainly deals with petroleum and with energy, for instance. So in this case, perhaps Abdullah, if he's going to build his own social accounting matrix, he will build a detailed matrix for the energy sector because that's his sector of interest. So he's going to have 10 sectors of energy, but perhaps 2 sectors of services and 2 sectors of manufacturing and 1 sector for agriculture because his interest is energy. So the level of aggregation or disaggregation of the social accounting matrix depends on my research question. If personally I'm running a CGE model on trade policy and what matters for me is the manufacturing sector, then in this case, I will have a manufacturing sector that includes 20 sectors, for instance, 1 service and 1 agriculture. If I'm simulating a climate change scenario that will affect the agriculture sector, then in this case, I will have to disaggregate the agriculture sector because that's the sector of interest, and I will aggregate all the other sectors and so on. So the level of aggregation and disaggregation depends really on the research question that we have. So that's why we have to first identify what is the research question. Second, we gather the data from different sources. In general, we gather the data on fiscal issues from the Ministry of Finance. We gather exports and imports from the central bank. We gather the national accounts from the statistical agency or from the Ministry of Planning or in Morocco, Le Haut Commissariat au Plan and so on. So we gather those different sources. And then we have to adjust them, make sure that the sum of each row is equal to the sum of each column, because that's what guarantees that we're going to have an equilibrium. And finally, this will help us have a matrix that is ready to use for single country models. There are other ready sources like the GTAP source, which is the Global Trade Analysis Project. It's a consortium of institutions that construct their own social accounting matrices coming from different national sources. They harmonize those different social accounting matrices and constructed a whole data set for that includes harmonized social accounting matrices for different countries at the world level. Okay? So that's the way we construct a SAM. I will not go into the technical details of constructing a SAM, but as I said, I will send you some documents that show you how you can do that. What's important now is to see the basic structure of a social accounting matrix. So the social accounting matrix includes different cells. Each cell shows the payment of the column to the row, and we'll explain this now. And the social accounting matrix, given the fact that it has, each cell represents a payment and a revenue, then in this case, we can apply the principle of double entry. And this double entry means that the total revenues that we have in the SAM must be equal to the total expenditure, which is the total of the column. We have six accounts in any SAM, factors of production, activities, commodities, the capital account, the capital account, the saving and which shows the saving and investment. We have the rest of the world, and all this, I mean, for all the accounts, we must make sure that the sum of each row is equal to the sum of each column, okay? Then it's also important to distinguish between activities and commodities, because the activities, they produce the goods, but the commodities are the goods themselves that are sold in the market. In other words, the activities, they will produce these goods, they will offer these goods to the market, and the market will sell these goods, these goods as commodities. So that's why we will see in the matrix that we have to distinguish between the activities that produce and the goods that are and the commodities that are consumed by different economic agents, households, firms, government, and so on. Okay. All this in general, the SAM includes also domestic and foreign institutions. So domestic institutions are households, firms, government, and the foreign account is the one that includes exports and imports, which is the rest of the world. Okay. In general, in the SAM, we will see that household, they are going to consume and to save. Firms, they are going to save and to invest. And the government will collect taxes and will spend on different either transfers to households and to firms, or will spend also on social services, for instance, education, health, and so on, okay? So this slide shows the basic structure of a social accounting matrix, where we have all the economic flows between different agents. So as I said, first we have here in the columns, we have the expenditure, and in the rows we have the receipts, okay? So what does this, let's say, for instance, this cell show, okay? It shows what factors pay to households, okay? So as I said, for each cell, the columns, they pay to the rows. So this column, factors, pays to households. So economically speaking, what does this cell mean? It means that the factors of production in terms of labor and capital, they will compensate the households for the services they are providing to the factor market. And that's why this cell represents the factor income to households. So again, it's the factor that pays to households. Let's take a second example. This one, for instance, government consumption. It shows that the government pays to the commodities, right? So here the government pays the amount of the goods that are consumed from where? From the commodities market, and so on. So all these cells can be read the same thing. So for instance, let's take the case of exports here. So the exports are produced domestically, but who pays for the exports? It's the rest of the world. So the rest of the world will pay the amount of exports to the commodities market, because it's the commodities market who's going to provide these goods. So Let's look at the commodities now horizontally. So this way, sorry. So here I'm looking at the commodities account at the row level, and here I'm looking at the commodities account at the column level, okay? So what does this show? Commodities are the goods that are sold themselves. So these goods are consumed by whom? Are consumed either by other activities. So other economic activities, they are going to buy some goods in order to produce other goods. And that's why this represents the intermediate inputs. So they will pay to the commodities the price of intermediate inputs. And then in order to transport these goods from a market to the other, we need the cost of logistics. And the cost of logistics is the transaction cost, meaning that the commodities market is going to pay the price of the services, the transport services that are provided by the transport sector, which is part of the commodities. Then households are going to pay the price of their own consumption to the commodities, and that this shows the private consumption. The government will do the same for the government consumption. Then firms will do the same for investment. The rest of the world will pay exports. And this shows here the total demand for commodities. Okay? So here I'm looking at this, at the commodity sector from the demand perspective. From the supply perspective, so the commodities, they will buy from the activities what has been produced, and that's the marketed output. There is part also that is associated to the logistics or the transportation cost. Then that's the commodities they have to pay to the government sales tax and tariffs. The commodities will pay to the rest of the world the price of imports and what has been produced domestically plus what has been imported shows the supply. So the supply that I have here, which is domestic production plus imports, must be equal to the demand. And that's the double entry story that we have in the social accounting matrix. Is this clear? Any question? Okay, so the same interpretation holds for all the other cells that we have, and every time we must have an equilibrium between the sum of the row and the sum of the column. We can take a second example. For instance, households, they will have to pay the price of their home consumed output, meaning that the goods that they produced for subsistence. They will pay to the commodities sector the price of private consumption. They can do some transfers to other households. They will do some transfers to the government. They will save, and all this will show their expenditure. So the sum of all this is their expenditure. Where does income come? Where does their income come from? So their income will come from their factors of production, from other transfers that come from other households, then from the dividends that are paid by enterprises to households, from the transfers that are provided by the government, from the transfers that come from the rest of the world, and this shows their total income. So their total income must be equal to their total expenditure. Is that clear?
Good.
Any question, anything that's not clear?
I want to ask about the first column, receipts.
Yes.
and the receipts, activities, commodities, factors, household, etc. This item depend on what these items you choose. These items.
So the, here, those items are by definition the items that are, that have been identified by the system of national account of the United Nations. So we have the activities, we have commodities. Okay, that's the, so the first and the second account, the account of activities, the account of commodities, the account of factors of production, and then we have institutions, which are household, enterprise, and government. So that's one account. We have savings and investment, another account. And finally, we have the rest of the world, which is an external account, because it deals with the rest of the world. So those six accounts are the accounts that are included in any social accounting matrix. And then each account can have a lot of cells. It can have from one cell up to 100 of cells. But the accounts themselves are relatively the same in different social accounting matrices.
Yes.
Please, I have a question. Yes? Activities of whom or of what?
The activities of in the economy. So the activities here, they will represent the agricultural, the economic activity. I mean, the agriculture sector, the chemical sector, the ready-made garment sector, the textile sector. All these activities are considered as economic activities that produce goods. These goods that are produced will go to the commodities account, which is this one. And the commodities account, it shows what is marketed and what will be bought by different economic agents, households, firms, governments, rest of the world, and so on.
Okay.
Other questions?
Yes, I do have a question regarding, I just rebound on the question that has been just asked regarding the activity. So it's disaggregated with respect to the sectors.
It really depends on your research question. So right. The minimum that we can have is agriculture, industry, services. But then instead of having one, for instance, for Mauritania, if the agriculture sector is important, then in this case, we're going to split the agriculture sector into 10 sectors. Animal agriculture, vegetable agriculture, fisheries, raw products, and so on. And I will have just one sector for the manufacturing sector and one other sector for services. But for another economy like Lebanon, for instance, where the services sector is important, then in this case, I will split the service sector into 20 sectors and I will have just one manufacturing sector and one agriculture. For Egypt, Tunisia, Morocco, and Jordan, where the manufacturing sector is important, I will tend to have more manufacturing sector than agriculture and services, and so on.
I understand. So in the next role, commodities, shall I expect to have a sector disaggregation as well, or there will be another?
Exactly. But in some cases, we can have more commodities than activities in case we have an activity that produce more than a product.
I see. Okay. So thank you.
Other questions?
Doctor, excuse me, I have one question. It might be very trivial, but usually we use to consider households as a factor of production as labor. So when we just split between them in this table, I don't know where to put values. Can you?
Okay, this is a very good question, actually, because we distinguish between households as an institution that provides its service and an institution, and that consumes from the fact that all households, they will provide their service of work, meaning the labor, to the factors market, and the factors market will have a pool of labor. So what I have here in the factors, it's labor and capital that has been collected from different households and from different enterprises, okay? So in other words, here in the cell, the value added, it will include what the activities pay to the factors, right? So here the activities, they will pay the price of capital and the price of labor to the factors, okay? Which means that here we're going to have the wage bill and the capital remuneration amount. Once the factors receive from the activities the amount of the value added that includes both capital remuneration and wage compensation, factors, they will pay the wages to households and the dividends to enterprises. And once households, they will receive this amount, enterprises will receive this amount from the factors. And once they do this, they will use this, households, I mean, they will use this amount in order to pay for what? For the private consumption. So households here, they will take this money in order to pay the price of the private consumption, to do some transfers, to pay taxes to the government, and what is not consumed and what is not paid as taxes will be at the end saved.
Okay, I got it. Thank you, Doc. Thank you, I got it.
Other questions? So it's very important to distinguish between, I mean, the distinction that we have between activities and commodities holds also on the, for the distinction between factors and households. Because activities and commodities, if you wish, they are two facets of the same thing. On the one hand, activities they produce, but at the same time, once they produce the commodities, they have to go to the market, and the commodities market is going to market these products for selling, and they will be bought by different institutions. The same thing, households, they will offer their service of work on the market of factors of production. The factors of the market of factors of production will collect different different factors of production in order then to provide these factors to the activities. Activities will use these factors of production in order to produce the goods that will be sold by that will be bought by households and by other institutions like the government or the rest of the world. So in a nutshell, the distinction between activities and commodities holds also for factors and households or enterprises, because household and enterprises, they have different behavior, but they belong to the same institutions. Other questions?
One question, Professor, if you don't mind.
Sure.
Totally understood that it's up to me to choose the level of disaggregations across all levels. What about the calculation, the computation within the system, the CGE model? Is it going to be like on the disaggregated level or the aggregated level? And that's will lead me to another question. So am I assuming that every subsector here is a variable in the model?
Okay, so to answer the first question, in general, when I disaggregate the SAM, this means that I will use this level of disaggregation in my CGE model. Otherwise, I will keep the aggregated version of the SAM. So once I disaggregate it, this means that I need this in my research question, and consequently, I will use this in my research, okay? That's for the first question. The second question, on variables, yes, each subsector in theory will be considered as an endogenous variable unless one of the sectors does not have an equation. And in this case, I can assume that the production of the sector is exogenous. I will give you an example. For instance, public spending on health or education or social services in general, it's a it's a decision by the government. So in a sense, it can be considered as an exogenous decision. And that's why, for instance, in the SAM, if I have 11 sectors, three service and two agriculture and six manufacturing. So I can assume that the two agriculture and the six manufacturing are endogenous, but the three service sectors are exogenous because they are determined by a government decision. I can keep them, if I want to endogenize them, I can endogenize them. But that's what I mean by choosing to exogenize some sectors and to endogenize other sectors or to endogenize all sectors. It really depends on my research question and on the structure of the model I have. Is that clear?
Very clear, thank you so much.
Other questions?
Yes, please, Dr. Shahir. I'm asking about activities with activities. It's a cell of activities with activities. What does it mean?
It doesn't have a meaning, and that's why it's empty. So you will see here that in some cases, the SAM include empty cells. And this means that those cells, they don't have an economic meaning. And that's why all this is empty actually.
Okay. Can the diagonal be empty or the diagonal be empty?
You mean this one?
Yes, or all of them?
No, but actually, it's very difficult to generalize because even on the diagonal, we have some cases where we have some values and in other cases where we do not. So for instance, here between commodities and commodities we have. Between factors and factors, it's empty. But then between the rest of the world here and the rest of the world, in some matrices, we can have some transfers going from the rest of the world to the rest of the world, meaning that something like, loans going from international donors, for instance. Mm-hmm. So in general, it really depends because at the end of the day, to answer your question, there is no rule because the criteria is that each cell must have a meaning. What I will look at is the individual cell itself. And perhaps to clarify this, I will stop sharing this document and show you. and show you in the last 10 minutes the social accounting matrix. For a paper on Egypt, what I was trying to see what happens if we remove all the administrative barriers to trade, what we call trade facilitation.
Okay.
And this social accounting matrix. So here is the ROSAM. You can see it?
Yeah.
So here we have, as you can see, we have a lot of cells that are empty. So all these empty cells, they don't have an economic meaning. But all the numbers that we have, they do have an economic meaning. And they cannot start working on a CGE model unless I understand every single flow in my SAM, which means that let's look at, as you can see here, So just to have a very general overview of the SAM, this is how the social accounting matrix look like. As you can see, we have an equal number of rows that is equal to the number of columns. So it's a matrix, that's one. Two, we have first the factors of production account. So labor and capital. We have institutions here. So households, urban and rural, private and public enterprise, the government, the rest of the world. Then we have the capital account. We have the activities. We have the commodities. And in the Egyptian case, we have independently taxes. But as you will see, I reconstructed the SAM in order to have the capital account, the composite commodities, the activities, the institutions, the rest of the world, and the factors of production. So I merged the taxes and subsidies with the government, because at the end of the day, it is the government. And then, so all these cells, they represent different economic flows between different agents and different sectors. And here I was just, as you can see, I did some color coding, but that was just, I mean, a personal preference in order to interpret each number on its own. Just to double check that I understand the economic meaning of every number before running the simulation or before constructing the CGE model. So for instance, here this number, as you can see, is the 28066. So you can see this number, right?
Yeah.
So here this 28066, it shows the payment of the government to labor. What does this represent from an economic perspective? What do you think?
Salaries, for example.
Salaries of whom?
Of the employment of the worker.
Whom? Of the employment, but not any employment.
A governmental employment.
Exactly, of those who are working in the government. So those yes. are the wages of public workers in the public sector, right?
Yeah.
And then we have here the payment of each activity to labor. So that's the amount of labor that is hired in the agriculture vegetable sector. That's the amount of labor in agriculture, animal, in oil and extraction, and so on. And the following line shows the capital. So here I have the capital that is hired in the agriculture sector. This one in the agriculture, animal, and so on. Okay?
Okay.
This is capital.
Sorry?
This is capital. What's the value? It's value or quantity?
Here, given the fact that I'm looking at the SAM itself, that's the value. So it's the value of capital remuneration and the value of wage compensation.
Okay.
Okay. Nasiruddin?
Yes, Dr. Shahir, I just have a question. So,
yes.
So my understanding is that the prices are to be normalized. That
yes.
is to set their value to one, right?
Right.
And in order to conduct the different analysis, like the Leontief analysis, we calculate what we call the Leontief multiplier. That is the identity matrix minus the design, the intermediate matrix. Mm. And this will not be feasible if the diagonal blocks remains not empty, because in order to get a non-singular or inversible matrix, you
Absolutely.
Have to get rid of all the diagonal elements to have a consistency, and that's the convergence of our simulation. Is that the case here? Is this the case here?
Actually, for the Leontief inverse, we do it, but for the input-output table here. And in the input-output table, we have values everywhere, because it's either there is no backward and forward linkage between the sector, or there is. So the Leontief inverse holds on the input-output table itself, which is part of the social accounting matrix. But we will see later that in some cases, when we want to invert a matrix and we cannot invert it, I will have to impose a condition, meaning that I will ask GAMS that you can run this command whenever you have positive values or for non-zero values.
And will that ensure the convergence criteria, the Levy convergence Definitely. Criteria?
Exactly. Because it's not really identical to what we do when we invert the matrix of Leontief, but it's more similar to, for instance, if I want to calculate anything, I don't know. I mean, I want to calculate the propensity to consume, for instance. And if if I want to calculate the propensity to consume, this means that I'm going to divide the consumption by income in order to calculate the share of consumption to total income, right? If for a certain agent, income is zero, then if I divide this number by zero, it is undefined, right? If it's undefined, this means that I will have to ask GAMS to impose a condition that according to which you can run this equation or this set of equations or do the matrix inversion for specific values when they are different from zero. If they are equal to zero, you have to skip them because you will not be able to do the inverse. But that's in general in the model. Talking about the Leontief inverse, it holds only for the input-output table that we have here.
Yes, Dr. Shahir, my concern is the convergence criteria, the number of iterations.
Yes, convergence is about doing the iterations in order to find the equilibrium.
Yes, but in this case, as you described, what the machine does is to assign a very small value to the zero value in order to not prevent the computation. So this lead to...
I didn't say this. I didn't say that we assign small values. I said that we impose a condition of not running a specific equation when it is divided by zero. Because if it's divided by zero, it is undefined. And if it's undefined, we will not be able to converge. So that's why I have to impose a condition on this equation to ask GAMS to avoid a specific sector, for instance, if the sector includes a lot of zeros and we're going to divide by zeros, which will lead to an undefined solution that will prevent the model from converging.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Other questions? Okay, so that's what the social accounting matrix looks like with all the different flows that we have in the economy. Okay, and as I said, before we start working on the model itself, we have to make sure that we understand very well every single flow in the economy, because for at least three reasons. First, because I have to make sure that each number is represented in my model, and I will not be able to do this unless I understand the economic meaning of the number. Second, because if I miss any number, this will lead to a disequilibrium between the rows and the columns that I have in the matrix, and this will lead to a disequilibrium in the model itself, because the imbalance of the matrix will lead to a disequilibrium in the model, and the model will not converge, okay? Finally, because each equation in the model must have a value from the SAM. If I have an equation in the model that does not have a value in the SAM, the model will not be solved. So that's why the model, in terms of mathematical notation or the equations, as well as the SAM, in terms of data, they have to be perfectly matching in order to guarantee that the model is computable and will be able to converge because the sum itself is balanced. Is this clear? Any questions? Anything that's not clear?
Yes, Shahir, it's clear. I have just a concern. Does it matter the number of subsectors in each, the unbalanced subsectors in each, for example, sector? For example, for activities, we see, for example, 12 or something. Commodity, we have 14 or 15. Instead, for labor and capital, or for factors, we have two factors. Does it matter when we have a number of number, a big number for each one of the classifications?
No, it doesn't. It doesn't matter at all because in general we just have two or three factors of production at most. Right. We have labor, capital, and land in some cases. So that's the maximum number I can have in the factors of production.
Yeah.
But for the activities and the commodities, I can have up to 120.
Right.
Or 200 even. Good. The only thing or the only constraint I must satisfy in the social accounting matrix is first that the number of rows is equal to the number of columns. Yeah. Of columns, course, that's one. And two, that the sum of each row is equal to the sum of each column.
Of course, yeah.
But then having 20 activities and 100 commodities and just one factor of production, it depends on the data I have and my research question.
Good. Thank you so much.
Other questions? Okay, so if we don't have more questions, now it's 7 p.m., so I will stop here. We'll continue Wednesday. Sorry, there is a question here. Is there a rule of thumb of choosing a reference here? No, it can change. It really depends on the most recent available data that you can have. For a country that is resource dependent with which fiscal depending or which fiscal spending are depending on revenues and sometimes on the rule of sovereign funds play a role in such revenues? No, because in any case, for social accounting matrices, we look at structural things. So in general, given the fact that social accounting matrices, they look at the structure of the economy at a certain point of time, rarely the share of a sector in total production will drastically change from year to the other. Meaning that if my economy is oil dependent, so on average, let's say the share of oil will be around 80%. In some years, it can be 78%. In some years, it can be 82%, but it will never be 10%. So that's why the choice of a reference year does not really affect the analysis unless we have an exceptional year. Like for instance, in Egypt in 2010, 2011, we had the revolution. So this was a year of instability. So if we produce a social accounting matrix, it will still reflect the structural characteristics of the economy, but it was an exceptional moment. But this is really rare and it does not significantly affect the structure of the SAM.
Yeah, my comment is the reason is if I'm learning about CGE and for a country like Saudi Arabia, you know, you could have a single year where oil prices are very high and the value added from that sector is quite high as well. But the government decides not to spend back the money. It puts it in its sovereign wealth fund or pay its debts or something not related, which translates back to the economy, especially if the state owns the resource, the resource. I'm just asking because if we work on doing something like this for Saudi Arabia or, for example, my future work, it's quite tricky in a sense to use CGE for a not representative year in which the oil revenue is reflected back to the economy through government expenditure. So for instance, if I choose a reference year that the money was not reflected back to the real economy.
I get your point.
Yeah.
But yeah, please.
Yeah, if you got my point, do you suggest that the importance of referencing a year, especially for a resource depending economy, it's quite important, correct?
In terms of structure, I don't think it will matter for two reasons, because there is a modeling issue and there is a data issue. So in general, the production of the sector itself, will have to be fully reflected in the SAM. Because if you produce, let's say, the production of oil represents 70% of the Saudi GDP.
60%, yeah.
Sorry?
60%.
So those 60% will be reflected in the SAM, okay?
Mm.
We agree on that.
Yeah.
So given that they are represented in the SAM, in this case, they have to be definitely compensated somewhere in the SAM. Otherwise, you will have an outflow that is not represented in the SAM, which means that the SAM will not be balanced and you will not be able to run the CGE model.
Yeah.
So even if you have an amount that was invested in a sovereign wealth fund or that was used in order to pay the debt of Saudi Arabia, it has to be either represented in the capital account of the saving investment equilibrium or the fiscal account where part of it has been used in order to reduce the debt of the government.
Yeah, great. Thank you for your clarification.
So at the end of the day, the choice of the clearly, I mean, if you choose, if you use a SAM for two different years, you will have slightly different figures. But from a structural perspective, things, they do not change. And that's why, in general, you will see that the most important part of an input output of the SAM, which is the input output table, is very stable. Because the technology of production that is represented through the technical coefficients of the input-output table is, in general, relatively stable over time. It can change over the long run, but not in the span of 4 or 5 years, for instance.
No, it's very clear. It's just that I've also experienced when looking at different IoT periods where, you know, different oil regimes were happening, the structure of the economy is definitely different. But for the Saudi case, it's quite tricky, as you would imagine. But thank you for your clarification. It was very valid points. Thanks.
Thank you. Other questions? And clearly, I mean, to complete my answer also to Abdulillah, is that I can even model the existence of a sovereign wealth fund in my model, I mean, in the CGE model, just to show how the sovereign wealth fund will invest this or will reinvest this in the economy, and to show how over time, because at the end of the day, a sovereign wealth fund is, it's like, in terms of behavior, it's like an investment fund. An investment fund is associated to the dynamics of the model. So what I invest today will affect the economy tomorrow. And this can be tackled through a dynamic model.
Gotcha. But thank you so much for the clarification.
Other questions? Okay, so if we don't have more questions, we'll stop here and we will meet next Wednesday at 4 p.m. To continue with the GAMS code and the first model that we'll code together. Thank you and have a nice evening.
Thank you so much, Dr.
Thank you very much.
Thank you guys, everyone, and all your contributions. Thank you.